I think it's a great opportunity for us to be here and talk about Rooibos in Rooibos territory. So I'm very excited about this opportunity, and I want to thank the organizers for having the insight to have an international conference in Clanwilliam. I think it's great. Right, so I'm going to talk to you a bit more about the health aspects of Rooibos and more about focusing on the human side of it. I think I've spent about 15 years looking at the in vitro side and also the animal experimentation side, and it's now, I think, high time that we go into humans and see what does it do. Because we all know, yes, we can have animal studies and in vitro studies, but the proof is in the pudding, and once you give it to humans, what happens? So I'm going to... Oh, where's the ticker thingy? Right? That is instruction. Right, so why are we looking at humans and rooibos? We found that a lot of human diseases are linked or have been linked to oxidative stress. Oxidative stress, I'm not going to go into the whole explanation, but literally it's an imbalance that takes place in your body between oxidants and antioxidants. Now our body is totally equipped to deal with any stresses that comes our way. It has a very good antioxidant system, the defense system that we all have. But the thing is, as we get older, you know, like everything else, as we get older, the protection goes down. So we need to help our bodies in any case. But a lot of the diseases that have been linked with oxidative stress is the diseases that's currently very out there and really affecting our human population, like heart disease, like diabetes, and we all heard from previous speakers that there's a really big increase in these non-communicable diseases, and we have to do something to help. And I always say it's better to prevent than actually go back and try and cure something. So I'm going to talk to you from a prevention point of view to actually prevent some of these diseases. And how we're going to do that is by looking at specific dietary compounds that we are taking in every day. Can't those compounds help us? And rooibos is part of those compounds we take in every day. Right, so we're going to either change our lifestyle, okay, and make certain dietary changes, and we're going to focus to include these phytochemicals in our diet. And these plant compounds definitely, as we've heard before, possesses your health promoting properties. Can we do that and include and see if there's a link between the increase in these phytochemicals that we take in and out diet and then prevent some of our lifestyle diseases? Right, so in terms of human studies, we've done a few, I think five up to now. I'm going to focus on two of them because two of them, Hannah's given you a third one that we are looking at. And remember, all of these studies we are looking at induced oxidative stress. So this is my personal view. I think we all have the system, as I said, and we all are very capable. But once our bodies come under oxidative stress, that is the time that we need to have this intervention. So in the first human study we did is we looked at people at risk for heart disease. They are all under oxidative stress. These people were not taking any medication, so they were kind of in a pre-phase before progressing to heart disease. We looked at them and we classified them according to the Framingham as well as some other categories as well. So none of these patients were on any medication and were on no supplements. We just asked them to drink 6 cups of rooibos tea for 6 weeks. And we monitored, obviously, the safety data. We also monitored the total iron, because there's a lot of chemicals in rooibos that you think could bind iron if you do take a cup of rooibos with your food. And then we also obviously looked at the lipid profile of these people. Right, so that's just the basic study where we asked participants to consume. We kept their dietary records. We asked them to not go and eat 5 apples a day, you know, stick to 1 apple a day, because all of those things have antioxidants in them. And we want to be sure that the effect that we are going to see in the end is going to be because of the rooibos that they are consuming and not because of the diet that they are following. And then obviously we monitored some of the health checks, as well as took blood samples at certain periods and did a lot of assays. If you want more details on those, Please come talk to me. Right, so the first thing, everyone always asks me, is it safe? How do we know it's safe to drink rooibos? Well, this was 6 cups of rooibos for 6 weeks, and we didn't see any detrimental effects of rooibos on these different parameters measuring your liver and your kidney function. Right, so these people took in daily 343 milligrams of rooibos, and that could work out from the dietary records that they completed, and the controls only 27. So there you could see most of their flavonoids that they were taking came from the rooibos that they were consuming. And it correlated obviously with a significant increase in the total polyphenols level that we saw in their blood at the end. We also monitored the blood pressure, and there was no effect on blood pressure. Right, so the fermented rooibos contains, as you've heard before, a multitude of these polyphenolic compounds, and it's anticipated that, as I said, in terms of iron, that they could bind the iron and result in an iron, a decreased iron absorption. But we did a whole lot of a battery of assays to assess the iron binding capacity in these participants, and none did rooibos affected none of these biomarkers. And so in the South African context, we could definitely say that rooibos did not have an adverse effect on the markers of the iron status in these people. Right, so now we're going to look at lipid oxidative damage. Why are we looking at these biomarkers? Because that is really, if you go beyond them, that is the start of atherosclerosis. It's very connected to your heart disease. Right, so if we look at Malonga Alvar, the T-bars, measured as T-bars and conjugated dienes, that just means it's an earlier marker of lipid oxidation, that's a later marker. And we were very surprised to see both rooibos to decrease the early marker of lipid oxidation as well as the late marker of lipid oxidation. So definitely rooibos had a significant effect in decreasing the lipid damage, oxidative lipid damage. Okay, in terms of your redox status, remember I said we all have an endogenous system in our body. It contains glutathione. That glutathione is a little miracle molecule. It takes a lot of oxidative hits for our body. And what does rooibos do? Remember, you can't take in glutathione. Your body produces it, but you can't take it in. So rooibos actually, the intake of rooibos caused a 36% increase of this molecule. Glutathione, and when we looked at the oxidized glutathione, you will find this molecule gets oxidized when there's a lot of stress. We found that the oxidative, the rooibos caused a decrease in this oxidized glutathione as well. And if we look at the ratio of reduced to oxidized, we found a great increase there, all significant, which is tells us that rooibos taking it in gives your body a fighting chance against all these oxidative onslaughts that we are facing every day. And you're not just getting that in from normal things that you think, like smoking or bad diet or anything like that, sun can affect it, anything like that. So it's not, if we think about it, your body gets hit by these oxidizing events a few thousand times a day, and it must have a chance to actually, you know, fight against that. So that is what it is. So in terms of our cholesterol profile or our lipid profile, rooibos did a great job there as well. Nearly a 10% decrease in total cholesterol, although that was not significant, but the significant part came in the different types of cholesterol that rooibos affected. So your bad cholesterol was decreased, your good cholesterol was increased, as well as your triacylglycerol. Those are your free ones floating in your blood, really in your plasma. And it was decreased by 29%, all statistically. So this also tells us why did we see less damage? Because there's less of these molecules to be damaged. Right, so that's just to show you and remind you that the link between your bad cholesterol and the good cholesterol and your cardiovascular disease, that is the link. So if you can decrease your bad cholesterol, you can also reduce your risk for heart disease. If you increase your good cholesterol, you definitely reduce your risk by 3%. So that's just to give you a reminder of the connection. Right, so that was the first study we did, and we published that, and that was great for us. we had some very good news that we received a 5 million contract now, money, funding to actually continue with this study. So from next year on, we will definitely start and then enhance the study. Right, so the next study that we did is we look now at postprandial induced oxidative stress. And just about every one of us, we are under postprandial or in a postprandial state, meaning after you've eaten, your oxidative stress goes up. And most of us, if you follow, I don't know whose diet or recommendations to follow, but there's a lot of them. Most of them recommend you eat every few hours or something. Every time you take food in, you are in oxidative stress. So we thought, let us look at a typical Western diet. So this is a diet that you would go to a McDonald's or whoever, and you will go and buy your food, a typical Western diet, and you will consume it. You can't see the glass there, but you will consume it with a soda or a beverage containing high sugar. So we had participants, 14 of them, consuming this standardized packed meal with a commercial soda. They were our control group. And then, of course, we just substituted that glass of soda with Rooibos. Also containing glucose or sugar, but it was just Rooibos. And we gave that as the other control group. Right, so what happened? This was quite exciting for us to see. Obviously, in the phase one of pilot, we confirmed that we actually, this diet and the soda definitely induced oxidative stress. That we confirmed, and then we went on to the phase two. So when we substituted that soda with Rooibos, what happened? You will see this is your serum antioxidant capacity, and this is just another method by measuring it, your teeth. You could find 4 hours after you've eaten the meal with the beverage, your antioxidant capacity increases. And this is 4 hours. Now, a lot of people say, yes, but these polyphenols actually start spiking at around 2 hours, 1.5 hours. But that is because you are eating it or taking in the Rooibos with something that's fatty or with a protein or a carbohydrate. That kind of prolongs before it goes spikes into your blood. That is the reason why. Right, so we also found that with your control diet or your soda, we didn't see any increase in antioxidant capacity there. So already that gives your body a fighting chance to actually help against the oxidative stress that eating this fat diet is giving you. Okay, so what did we see in terms of the lipid damage products? Remember I explained that previously we found that the conjugated diets, the early marker, was definitely decreased by Rooibos. Sorry, that is the trials, not this was. I'll come to that now. But again, in terms of your conjugated diets, your early marker, it was definitely decreased by Rooibos. This line here is the Rooibos line, and that is the commercial soda line. So commercial soda line, it was high at 2 hours, high at 4 hours, where Rooibos did not do that, did not enhance this increase. Where your late marker of lipid damage, you will find at 4 hours, where we also found an increase in antioxidant capacity in Rooibos, it actually caused a decrease that enhanced oxidative damage that you're seeing there with the soda. So in terms of your lipid profile, we looked at the serum azole glycerols, your triazole glycerols, and we found Rooibos to definitely not enhance at 4 hours this level, but your commercial soda did as well as at 6 hours. So you will find that Rooibos has a very unique way of where it interferes and how it interferes with some of your biomarkers. Right, so what we found is definitely the Rooibos beverage with a standardized meal did not further promote this damage, the postprandial oxidative stress that we saw with the increase in antioxidant status as well as the decrease in your lipid oxidative damage. It decreased your short-term induced postprandial oxidative stress by modulating your lipid profile. Remember, your triazole glycerols went down by increasing the antioxidant capacity. Your teeth level went up, and that we didn't see any level change on your food is fine, but we did say see something on your oxidative liver damage, your feces, and your CBOT. Right, so those were the two human studies that we could do by using different mechanisms of inducing oxidative stress. The other studies, from the other studies as well that have been published, up to date, we kind of look at the different mechanisms that Rooibos uses to actually protect you against cardiovascular disease. And it could be because of the antioxidant capacity. It could be at an epigenetic level where this ratio is improved. It could be at an anti-inflammatory capacity where we've shown in a rat model that Rooibos actually reduces these pro-inflammatory cytokines, okay, as well as your oxidative liver damage. It could also be because Rooibos has a prebiotic effect, and that we saw again where we saw taking in Rooibos and we saw a decrease in this LDL and triglycerides in your blood. And then also maybe by increasing your nitric oxide bioavailability, but humans consuming that, we don't see any level effect on nitric oxide. What it did do, this was a study published by Person, it did actually inhibit this ACE enzyme, the ACE enzyme activity, which is your angiotensin converting enzyme, a very important enzyme in the development of cardiovascular disease. So what I'm trying to say for all these slides is Rooibos doesn't just have one mechanism of protection. It has various mechanisms of protection that plays a role. And it depends on the disease, it depends on the origin, it depends on what you are using, what model you are using, Rooibos is going to be different. Right, so to add on to the heart study that we did, also a colleague of mine at the University of Clanwilliam, she looked at steroid metabolite ratios, and she found that the cortisol-cortisone ratio was significantly lower by Rooibos. In your study, males and study females, about a nearly 7% reduction. So this means Rooibos favors the inactivation of cortisol. Cortisol is your stress hormone. So that's another mechanism of Rooibos, how it can help and work with your body. Right, so other evidence that we also found that's published, I told you about Persons, that she published a lot, another article in 2012, if I'm not mistaken, where Rooibos actually inhibits this ACE enzyme activity at 30 minutes and 60 minutes after taking it in. And they say that it's the first line treatment for these ACE inhibitors for hypertension. So this is again another mechanism how Rooibos can be good for you. Right, so it was also recognized by someone to say that Rooibos finally gets the scientific nod for cardiac benefits. Other Rooibos research worldwide in terms of humans, they found that it increases your hair density, hair growth, number of hair follicles. Follicles, so these are for males going bald, they were treating. Women worried about the wrinkles that are increasing with age. It was a mixture between Rooibos and green tea on the skin. Twice a day they applied it for 28 days, nearly 10% reduction in wrinkles. Okay. So, I think if we take everything into account, all these things that we have up to now that's been published, and that the research are showing us, we can definitely say that definitely Rooibos has a relevance as a beneficial beverage for us. And why there's no reason not to make Rooibos part of your daily, health regime. So go for it, have your cup of Rooibos. But be balanced and have your glass of red wine and your cup of coffee. There's goodness in all of those things. Right, so I leave you with that message. Any questions?